So this morning when I woke up and was thinking quantum as usual, that quote of Freeman Dyson, that every quantum experiment forces the atom to make a choice, appeared somewhere on my feeds. And I remember that when I was debating Richard Dawkins, and I use that quote, from Freeman Dyson, every quantum experiment forces the atom to make a choice. Richard screamed at me, said, Freeman Dyson could not have said that. If he said it, he was wrong. But he didn't say it, and he should sue you for misquoting him. So, of course, I have the book here somewhere where the quote came from. It's called Infinite in All Directions. And so I wrote to Freeman Dyson, who was then alive. He passed away a few years ago, in his 90s, one of the greatest physicists of all time, contemporary of Einstein, etc. I said, did I misquote you? And are you going to sue me? And he very politely wrote back to both me and to Richard, I have no intention of suing anyone, but three riddles have always perplexed me my whole life. Number one, a universe fine-tuned for mind and consciousness. Number two, our own consciousness. And number three, the unpredictable movement of atoms. And then he said, I don't know the answers to these riddles, but I think they're somehow connected. So that was that. And this morning, when I actually saw the feed on that quote, I decided to go on Google Bard and said, what exactly did Freeman Dyson mean? Although I know what he meant, and he communicated with me what he meant. But then, people have their own opinions, and these large language models actually are nothing other than prevailing opinion. I challenge them and we go back and forth, but they will not go beyond prevailing opinion. So here's what Google Bard said about Dyson and what he meant. He said, the quote is indeed attributed to Freeman Dyson and captures a key aspect of quantum mechanics, but it also deserves some unpacking for further clarity. Here's a breakdown. What Dyson meant: atoms in superposition. In the quantum world, particles like atoms can exist in multiple states simultaneously, a phenomenon called superposition. This is unlike our closed classical world, where an object is in a definite state at any given time. Next bullet point, collapse of the wave function. When we perform a measurement on an atom in superposition, the act of measurement forces the atom to choose one of the possible states it was in. This is called collapse of the wave function and is a fundamentally probabilistic process. Then it goes on with the prevailing opinion. Dyson's quote uses the word choice figuratively. Atoms don't possess consciousness or make decisions in the same way as we do. The choice refers to the sudden transition from superposition to a single defined state triggered by the interaction with the measurement apparatus. Remember, the measurement apparatus is created by a conscious being. So behind all the apparatuses, there's a conscious being. So overall, Dyson's quote beautifully captures the counterintuitive nature of quantum mechanics and the collapse of superposition. Etc. etc. I hope this explanation clarifies whether the embodied observer, the method of observation, and the behavior of quantum particles are entangled as a single process in awareness is complex and fascinating. I asked that question, whether the embodied observer, the method of observation, and the behavior of quantum particles are they entangled as a single process, and Google Bard said It's fascinating, with no definite answer. It falls at the intersection of quantum mechanics, philosophy of consciousness, and cognitive science. So, no answer to that. So here's where I think the issue lies. The embodied observer is actually part of the scenery. Once again, the embodied observer, in this case, let's say Deepak Chopra, using a double slit experiment that I have to choose, the apparatus. Do I see a wave? Do I see a particle? Well, the embodied observer has to choose. But is the embodied observer not part of the scenery? Right now, I and everything I'm observing, I as the Deepak Chopra body mind, and everything I'm observing is all happening simultaneously. So the embodied observer with the classical apparatus, no matter what it is, the double split apparatus or, hadron collider, all of that is part of the scenery. I'll say it again. Me, Deepak Chopra, as a body mind with all the apparatus, and then the particle I'm observing, that's all one process. Okay, and it's the scenery. The fundamental place where this is all happening is awareness, which is the only subject of experience. And it's non-local, it's not in space-time. As I've said, it's without cause, irreducible, fundamental, shapeless, and not perceivable or conceivable. But it's a field of awareness that knows itself as all the scenery, including Deepak, the apparatus, and the observed particle. So once we get rid of the notion that the embodied observer, so-called, is the seer, then I think it becomes obvious that consciousness is manifesting in every moment as both what we call the seer and the scenery. But fundamental reality is neither the seer nor the scenery, but that in which both co-arise simultaneously. And knowing this is knowing who we are. We are not the body mind. And that's part of the scenery. And it's the changing scenery, along with the other scenery, which is also changing. You are the unchanging awareness in which seer and scenery simultaneously co-arise. Let me know. And that's very important, because if you're that, then you're not in time and you're not subject to birth and death.